Hey, feels like it has been forever since I've been on here. And it was that Pam Bernard did a slideshow of that first trip that I went on to help out with the tornadoes. And that says well, I didn't know it was going to be a 20-minute video, but it says a lot of the things that I was wanting to convey, but there's a lot more. Just getting there, I had no idea what to expect. Man, I hope
Truman, that is very annoying.
You got a chew toy, and all you can do is hear him munching. It's like chewing on corn nuts in the theater. That's just bad taste. Anyway, first things first, I guess. I was supposed to go with a buddy of mine that I used to work with. I was going to touch base with him as soon as I got off of work, because he was off that day. And then I did. He was just avoiding every single advance I was trying to make. So finally he sent me a message saying he can't go because he's got to do blah, blah, blah. And I tried calling him, sent him a couple more messages. Nothing. He just bailed. But I decided in my mind I was gone no matter what. So I went by myself. That was kind of daunting, just because I didn't know what I was getting into, man. Every other time I'd done stuff like this, I was with a group, or even just one other person. But this lady that was heading up this big relief effort for the weekend said, well, I told her that I was going to be there. So I went. Turns out I didn't even spend that much time with her and her group. I teamed up with these two other guys with chainsaws, and we just went to town on trees that just took a wicked beating. And I was trying to find my place in one of those groups, and Samaritan's Purse they were doing chainsaw teams, but you had to go to some orientation, and then you had to wear chaps and gloves and a helmet, and that's just not really my kind of thing. So I ended up just going with gloves and sunglasses, and ended up meeting up with these two guys, and they're good guys, and they didn't know each other until they got there that weekend. They teamed up, I showed up, we all teamed up. And we had a lot of fun. But I did definitely want to appreciate all the prayer. I was walking down that main drag of the whole trailer park. I was sending my folks a message or uploading some pictures or something. I don't know what I was doing, but I was playing with my phone, just going down the side of the street, and I hear these dogs barking, and I didn't think much of it, and then the owner just started screaming. So then I look up, and I see this pit bull and like a boxer pit bull mix. They're just right up on me, just like right up in my business, but they're looking up at me, just smiling, and I said, huh, that's weird. I wonder why the owner's flipping out like that. So the owner comes and gets him, and then I just kind of keep doing my thing. And then one of these guys I teamed up with, this Cajun from Louisiana, he was like, hey man, those dogs just about had you for lunch. It's like, what? Apparently they were a lot more serious than I had paid attention to that first time. Because I didn't notice. By the time I had seen them, looked like they were all smiles. Then, The next day, those dogs just started getting more and more vicious, and for some reason, the owners didn't have the state of mind to put them in what was left of their house or to chain them up. There was a lot of other people that were having issues with the dogs, too. And I was walking adjacent to their yard, to this the dog owner's yard. And I was a little more self-aware that time. Then I heard the owner start screaming again. I heard the dogs bark. Something in me just said, bolt. So I took off. And then got behind the protection of a couple guys with chainsaws. Turns out, after I left that day, that second day, the sheriff came over and had to put one of the dogs down. Hey, video. So that was a cool thing. But honestly, man, I wish I could convey the ambience of everything about it to you guys. It was just devastation. I mean, everywhere you can't turn a blind eye in one direction, look the other way, and get away from it. You could almost not step on somebody's life. And the smells. When I first got there, I sent a message out to some people that were wanting to keep up, like my folks, Carrie, Pam, and Bernard. And the only way I could describe it was it's like a sawmill, a fuel refinery, a morgue, and I forget what the fourth one was. That smell was awful. Oh, a tire barn or something. Just all exploded all at once, and that was all you could smell. And you couldn't get away from it. Just like the, you know, that burning rubber smell? You mix that with death and rotten wood. You don't forget it. You just don't. But I don't even know what really impacted me the most that weekend. A lot of the owners, the stipulation was for us to go onto a property and clear it off. We had to have the approval of the owner and be on the lookout for anything they wanted to recover. And most of the owners, by the time I showed up, weren't there anymore. They couldn't stand to see what happened to everything they had invested their life in. So there was actually a pretty good level of autonomy, considering the diversity of volunteers that just showed up to help. Everybody just kind of found their niche. I think that was one of the coolest things about going and helping out with that huge effort. But the owners I did talk to, or that I heard about, they weren't in a good place mentally. I mean, think about it, man. You spend years and years and years paying off a house and just acquiring things that you think are going to make you happy. And then all of a sudden, it pops up on Facebook. Somebody found it 400 miles away. When people are faced with that kind of mortality, temporalness, you can tell it changes their perspective. Man, all these people wanted was just pictures, sentiments, just the things that don't have crap for cash value, but it means the world to them. In that slideshow, I talked about this older lady. She had a house, a good-sized steel barn that was mostly still standing, and just rubble all over. And the only thing she wanted out of all of that stuff was just this big tote full of her late husband's army medals and his pictures and just the memories. The stuff that you can't put a value on. Every single person was like that. There was one lady, she was looking for her wedding ring. And she was over on the far side of one side of the trailer park, is where her house was. And that was all she wanted, just a tiny little wedding ring. And she was just starting to reach her wit's end, man. Just about, you could tell she was fighting a breakdown just out of pride because there were so many people around. And I don't even know how, but some volunteers just found it in a little bush on the other side of the trailer park. And this was a good-sized trailer park, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of acres. It was just in a bush. And it was so cool when somebody would find something they were trying to recover. They would they'd do this little cluster of applause. And then it would just start rippling out as more and more people heard it. Because everybody knew what that meant. And that's what everybody was there for, man, just to help out. And that was pretty cool. And just the way everybody just found their spot. Nobody was competing. Everybody just, man, if somebody was cutting down this tree, we went on to the next one. We weren't looking for a plaque to acknowledge our efforts. Man, everybody was there to work. that was a nice change from my job. But you know, I mean, there'd be groups of people just organizing rubble into wood so we can burn it, because that was just too much debris to take all to a landfill. They would so they're putting piles of wood, piles of just garbage that shouldn't be burned, and then piles of metal. So people, guys with trucks and trailers, would just come by. They'd come through and pick up all that scrap, and then take it to a scrapyard, and use the cash to buy more supplies, or just give to the people or whatever. And then there was people just on four wheelers or ATVs. They would just have ice chests or trays of food, just driving around, stopping every so often. Every time they'd see volunteers, like, hey, you need whatever it was they were carrying around. Like Subway sandwiches, they donated 600 six-inch subs the first night. And there was just a bunch of stories like that. There was people from outside of Houston, Texas. I don't even know how far away that is, but it's probably like a seven-hour drive. And this guy, he just had a barbecue business, loaded up his catering trailer, and came over, set up shop, and just made sandwiches all day long. As volunteers would walk by, man, they'd get one, or in me and my buddy's case, three or four. That's just how it was. I mean, some people were comfortable unloading trucks, loading up more trucks to take to these people who couldn't get out. Or one thing that was awesome was as soon as I got off the highway, there was a casino, gas station, rest stop, like just a refreshment area, just right off the highway. And it was just like 200 yards in the opposite direction where I was going. So I wanted to stop there and just kind of stretch and psych up a little bit, you know. So I did. I mean, as soon as I got to where I was trying to pull into that gas station, there was this fleet of bikers. I mean, it's just typical biker stereotype, man. Angry sunglasses, just scraggly beards. I don't know if they stank or not. My windows were up. But there had to be like 50 or 60 of them, just one after another, after another, after another, going down the road. And, you know, I was kind of put out by that. It's like, what? You know, this is a four-way stop. It's not just three, and then these bikers all have the same right of way. So, you know, they finally all passed. I went in the park, just kind of walked around a little bit, got my bearings, called this chick I was meeting up with, And then by the time I got to where this trailer park was, there was this long line of bikers just set up like an assembly line, unloading a trailer full of supplies. As soon as they unloaded it, man, they loaded up and hauled out. They just showed up to help, and then they were back on the road. Oh, man, I'm trying to think of everything. There was just so much. The second day, after one of my favorite conversations, I had to put it in the slideshow. It was the picture of that jacked up SUV that was just like bowed. There was a jack there. So me and one of these guys were walking past him to get back to where there were some more trees to cut. We were like, hey, you trying to fix your flat tire? And then he just looks up at us and kind of sizes us up for a second. He's like, yeah, once I get that done, I can drive on out of this place. He's like, dude, you just lost everything. Why are you joking? I thought his upbeat attitude was pretty cool, pretty admirable. And the other guy, this Cajun, he's in the Army. He was stationed in Kansas, like 4 hours away, I think, from where we were that weekend. And I couldn't tell at the time because we were just there to work. We weren't there to preach at each other. But he's got a really stout heart for God. And I don't like just sitting down and chatting with people about where they're at spiritually just so I can judge them, you know, whatever it is church people do with people like that. But he had, let's say it this way. He reminded me a lot of myself when I had a lot of zeal and had almost no wisdom. It was like almost everything coming from him, any kind of communication, always had to do with how good God was and this and that and everything about God. You know, which is cool, but I can see how that would grate on some people. Anyway, I was there Saturday, Sunday, because I had to come back into town, but he stayed, I think he was there Friday through Tuesday morning, and on Monday, he said God told him to get a tetanus shot, so he just went up to the Red Cross station or Salvation Army or one of those, and just got a quick little shot in his arm. Later on in the afternoon, he stepped right onto a nail. I don't know if it went through his foot or if it just put a pretty good gouge in it. But you can't argue that that wasn't God telling him that. As far as going back to that place, I don't know. I sent a message to this lady that was heading up that relief effort. It's hard to believe it was only just a little over 2 weeks ago. Feels like months. And, I haven't heard back from her yet. So what I might do is just call Chambers of Commerce because I'm planning on going back somewhere around there. With all the tornadoes that hit there in like 10 days, I got plenty of choices. That shouldn't be funny. This next trip I made with a buddy of mine that I do still work with. It was last Monday and Tuesday. That's why I had to skip out on last week's broadcast. And after what happened on that first trip with that guy bailing on me, I wasn't real sure if I was going to be going alone or not. So I was just braced. I was expecting to go by myself, and it would have been a welcome surprise if I had company. So I was talking to this guy the night before we leave. And he was planning on getting a chainsaw from his uncle, because I guess his uncle had like four or five, and he was just going to borrow one. Turns out his uncle sold all of them. So he and I were talking, and I was expecting him to be like, well, crap, I can't get a chainsaw, so I don't know what good I'd be. He ends up going out and buying a better chainsaw than the one I have. Well, I don't know if it's better. I got a 16-inch steel, and he got an 18-inch Echo. So, still a really good chainsaw. So after he dropped the money to buy that beast, I figured he meant business about coming along. So then he and I got off of work Monday. We went to his house and picked up all of his stuff. Had to go to Home Depot and get some replacement blades and some barn chain oil, stuff like that for his chainsaw. Had to go to a different place to get stuff for mine because steel is very exclusive, I guess. They're too good to have their stuff in Lowe's or Home Depot. And then we went to my house, picked up all of my stuff, and then just shipped out. Didn't even know. All we knew was we were going to El Reno on the other side of Oklahoma City from Tulsa. That was all we knew. Once we got into town, we stopped at this gas station and just stretched our legs because like 2.5 hours. And I ended up calling the sheriff's office looking for some direction. And they're like, well, if you go over here, you just follow these directions, you end up at this field house here, and that's your go-to place. They'll send you out from there. So we end up going there. There's the fire chief, the city manager, a couple other big wig officials for that town. And they're the only ones in this huge gymnasium just talking amongst each other. So me and this buddy walk in. And I'm just dressed like regular Joe. My buddy's got this like mohawk mullet thing. He's got big gauges in his ears. Just all tattooed up. He gets a little more attention than I do. So they see us walk in, and then they just kind of disperse. And then the city manager comes up to me, and the fire chief goes up to my buddy, and then we just start talking. So I start asking the city manager, hey man, we're from Tulsa. We just want to chip in and help out wherever we can. So if you want to point us in the direction, we should have the equipment we need for whatever we come across. And the guy's kind of thinking for a second. He's like, well, I'll tell you what, if you call the sheriff's office, they'd probably be able to get you lined up pretty well. I was like, well, I just did that, dude. They sent me here. This was, like 3 or 4 days after that tornado, I think. So they just told us the area where there was the most devastation. They said there was a trailer park near this juvenile detention facility. If we go this way, and then this way, and then this way, we'd find it. I don't know if I was just tired or their directions sucked, but we couldn't find the trailer parks. So we ended up just cruising around. I mean, it was when that tornado hit, it was primarily farmland. So a lot of stuff got screwed up, but not everybody's houses. So we had to drive a little more around than if we had gone closer to Oklahoma City. El Reno wasn't as densely populated. So we were just cruising, just looking for some place to help out. We ended up getting to the end of this one road, and there's this little house on the corner, maybe sitting on a half acre, just a little farmhouse, you know. House, modest little yard, property, and then farmland. We see this lady just on the other side of their entrance gate, and then a guy farther back on the property. So I back up. We just kind of pull into as far in their driveway as we could because they had that gate closed. And my buddy gets out, and I didn't realize this till afterwards. He was telling me on the way home. But my buddy gets out, and he goes up to the lady. He's like, hey, man, is there anything we can do for you guys? We're here to help, and we can't find anybody to help. So she kind of looks at him for a second, sizing him up. Because remember, he's not the Sunday morning churchgoer that we all picture. So she goes, gets her husband, and then he comes up, and he's retired. He's, I don't know, 60s, 70s. He still gets around pretty well. And then he comes, he sizes up my buddy, and then by that time, I just got sick of sitting there, so I got out of the car too, just see what was going on. Apparently, from what my friend told me, he was sizing up my buddy, trying to figure out just how much good this little guy was going to do, because I don't even think my friend comes up to my chin. I probably got 50 pounds on him. But Man, he's my favorite guy to work with, dude. He and I can throw down. So then he decides, you know, maybe we're not just a couple of looters or people looking for recognition or anything. So he opens up his gate. We kind of walk in there, see what's going on. And his whole quarter-acre, half-acre lot is just lined with cedar trees. And most of them were just beaten to death. So I was on the phone with some people trying to figure some other stuff out while my buddy was going through with the homeowners, figuring out where we start. And my buddy hadn't really done much stuff like this before as far as cutting down trees. Like, he'd used a chainsaw before. He helped me out with this monster stump I had in my backyard. We had to cut down another 3 feet off it before we could even get a stump grinder on it. But cutting trees down was, he was a little timid about that at first. So he and I were just kind of, I was babysitting him for the first hour and a half, just until he got real comfortable cutting stuff down that was still overhead. And that first day, we probably got, I don't know, 3 or 4 trees cut down out of the 14 or 15 that he was wanting. And then we were just kind of asking, where, is there any place to stay the night around here? What's going on? So he was like, well, I'll tell you what. You're not going to do this for free. And you're not putting me out because I'm insured for all this stuff. So you get me a receipt, then we can talk. So we ended up telling him we'd go get a receipt book and come back the next day. And then he told us that there was a couple of different spots with hotels around there. And I guess he thought we were just there for a couple hours. So when we told him we were going to come back the next day, I thought, what? And so we ended up, my buddy and I wrapped up about 9 o'clock, just the sun was starting to set, and drove into town just to find some dinner. We both ended up getting a bag of hamburgers and just wiped them out. But while we were sitting there, we were looking around for hotels. Like, there was one just up the road from where we stopped to eat. We walked in there, you know, I was thinking, no big deal. And the clerk, she comes up to us, sir, can I help you guys with something? So, yeah, we just want to get a room. Well, do you have a reservation? No. Do you have rooms? Turns out there was nothing available within like an hour, hour and a half, going either direction, even in Oklahoma City. So my buddy and I were just like, well, crap. And so we ended up going and picking up a receipt book and some more water and a couple other things we just didn't anticipate needing for our trip. And while we're there shopping, I'm calling all these other hotels just making sure they don't have any rooms. And there was one, she was like, well, I've got a single king smoking room. My buddy's a smoker, but sharing a king size bed would be kind of weird even with as good of friends as we are. So I told her I'd sit on it for a minute. Called her back 3 minutes later, and it was already reserved. And that was like a slap in the face. So then we were just kind of sitting there outside the store like a couple of hobos. And I'm just calling different hotels. Finally, I get a hold of one, and the guy's like, well, some people just checked out. It's being cleaned right now if you want to call back in 20 minutes. And it's like, well, that's kind of weird, cleaning a hotel room at 10:30 at night. But yeah, I'll definitely call back. So I did, and we got that booked and everything. And dude, that was a long day. He and I had to be at work at 5 a.m. I don't think we got bedded down till after 11 p.m. And then overnight, that whole Oklahoma City area, like where we were at, it got an inch and a half of rain in, I think, 2 hours. Just a massive storm that just blew through. It woke me up about 4:30 in the morning. And I was just thinking, oh, crap. I'm going to use my chainsaw and water. And I got to thinking, well, actually, God, you didn't send me over here to waste my time. So we'll figure something out. By the time we actually got up and around at like 7:30 or 8, there was some place where water was collecting, but man, while we were working, it was bone dry. So that was cool. And then we ended up getting back out to this guy's house, and we wiped out the last 8 or 10 trees in probably 6 hours. And then had some good chats with the guy, too. He was he's a good Christian guy. And he keep lecturing my buddy about the dangers of cigarettes. He said, man, you gotta put that death stick down, man. That's the reason I got diabetes and this problem and this problem. And, man, that's not good for you, blah, blah, blah. And my buddy was a good sport about it. But I think that guy was a good influence for my buddy. Because my buddy, he went to a Catholic boarding school, so he had about enough religion forced down his throat in the first 2 years of school to last him several lifetimes. And then after we got home from that trip, we were both just wiped out. Man, I was catatonic for, well, let's see, that got back Tuesday. I think just this last Sunday, I started actually feeling kind of energetic. But dude, since that first trip, man, God just dumped stuff on me. We'll get into that in a little bit. But I got to thinking about this second trip because it was such a stark contrast to the intensity of my first one. It's just the devastation, volunteers, the mentality, everything about it, man. This guy, from his second trip, man, he was like, well, got my wife, got my dogs. What do I have to complain about? And I remember a couple of the times when I first started really getting into to digging this relief effort stuff. It was a lot like this trip where we just went and cut damaged trees down for people. And my buddy's already chomping at the bit to go back. God said to rest up this week. And I'm going to try and get in touch with some people from different cities over there and see what help they still need. But that's not going to happen until at least next week. So as far as future broadcasts, at this point, it's all in the air. But that was a good one for my buddy to get warmed up on. Because he saw some devastation. Man, this guy had a big RV, like a big RV, just like a motorhome, and it was just upside down. They were like, dude, how did this happen? And he's like, well, if you look way over there, down at the other side of the field, you'll see that that's where I had that placed. That's where the thing was parked. That tornado man just picked it up. Just dropped it over here, and it, man, hundreds and hundreds of yards away. Just upside down, man. That thing was a mess. And I've been meaning to get some pictures from my buddy, so we can send them to Pam and Bernard, and it won't be quite the potentially riveting slideshow the first one was, but hey, it's something. Man, all the trees we cut down were cedar. I think that's one of my favorite trees to cut because that just smells so good. It was like man perfume, cedar wood. So, as far as the trips go, that was the gist of it. That first trip, that was Saturday to Sunday evening. And I got home, I was a buddy of mine had an extended weekend, and he's the guy I always play games with, so we get a chance, you know. Yeah. So I got off of work Monday, came home, played video games all day, because I knew soon as I was cutting that first tree in the trailer park on that first trip, God was really going to bring a couple things home for me when I got home and got a chance to distance myself from the intensity of what I was in the middle of, you know? So, I was playing video games with my buddy on Monday, and I can just feel God just starting to bring it together. You know how when you're out on a boat, you drop an anchor, and then you see the chain or the rope or whatever's holding the anchor? You see it just still going and going and going and going. That's what it felt like, man. It was just a matter of time till God just hit me with whatever he was trying to do. Sure enough, the next morning, man, I was at work. I felt like I got punched square in the gut. And all I wanted to do was just start bawling and then go find a corner to curl up in and just kind of just roll. I don't even know how else to explain it. Man, it's like God was, like I had a moment of weakness and God was able to sneak in there and make his point, man. Dude, that shook me up. And I'm still pulling stuff away from it. But one of the verses that just kept coming back to me over and over and over when I was just walking over everybody's belongings at that trailer park was these people beg for death and they won't find it. Death's going to escape them. It'll elude them. It's, yeah, Revelation 9:6. Much as I hate talking about end time stuff, just because so many people use it as a scare tactic, I have tried bartering with God about not talking about this, trust me. But that's something, for me personally, something shifted when I was at that trailer park. It was like, for all these years, God's working with me in the sparring ring, you know, just training, practicing, helping me get better, learn how to actually do something for him instead of just talk about what a great guy he is. And it was like this trip for me was what God needed to push me into the real world, almost. Like, I think that's the best I know how to explain it, man. All this stuff that, you ever have those moments with God where you're just sitting there and you know something's coming and it's like everything disappears and it's just you and God across the table from each other. And then he just lays all this stuff out. And he's like, hey, you still in this for the long haul? You still want to go where I'm wanting you to go? You want to do what I have for you to do? Because this is what it's going to be. This is what it's going to cost. You know, and then that's one of those where you don't just say yes because it's a spiritual thing. That's one of those where it's like giving God a permission slip to take you a little further. When I was still living in Washington, and I just kept doing the churchy thing, you know, God, I want as much of you as I can get. And then he had one of those little heart-to-hearts with me and showed me a lot of stuff. And some of the stuff from that trailer park was like what I had seen. This was 10 years ago, man. Funny how it all ties together, huh? And it's like God was just telling me, man, I'm finally starting to step into my time. It's not about helping, well, it still is about helping other people get to where they need to go to. But I used to hide behind doing that. You know, kind of like how people get so caught up in doing work for the church that they forget to have a relationship with God. It was almost like that. And it, man, just this last 2 weeks, I feel like, not like I hit a wall, more like I cleared a hurdle, I guess. And I just got this perspective. It's like, man, if we have truth, if we have God, it's either truth or it's not. Why? How? Can we just be sitting on our duff, not doing a single thing about it? Man, if we have truth, we need to be doing something with it. And if we have truth, if we have pure truth, unfiltered, unadulterated, pure, clean truth, if we have that, it almost seems like more of an injustice to just sit and do nothing. That's really what I've been struggling with lately. It's like, where's the line between love and making sure people know what they're doing? Because this parable, Jesus talking about this guy built his house on the sand, this guy built his house on the rock. Man, earthquakes, famines, pestilence, tornadoes, just natural disasters of all kinds are not going away. I don't understand how people who read the Bible and hear from God act like they're going to go away. There's a reason Jesus said if those days hadn't been shortened, nobody's going to survive. It's going to be rough. The people, the owners, the people that lived in that trailer park, the ones I did manage to talk to, most of them built their house on the sand. Man, something came, swept all of their life away, and they had nothing to stand on. I've been having some real good conversations with a friend of mine that I had known her for a while now, and then we had just gotten back in touch. I don't even know how we got on the conversation with God. Like, I don't know if it was me moving down here, I don't know, whatever. But she was I'm just very to the point and black and white and all that questions. I figure if a question, well, questions ought to lead me to answers that are the truth. So what's wrong with inspecting your foundation every once in a while? But this friend of mine didn't feel the same way. But how many people are just in denial about their relationship with God, with Jesus, about letting the Holy Spirit work on them where they're at? Man, between the tornado, well, the tornadoes in Moore and Shawnee, between that and then the tornado in El Reno, there was one in Broken Arrow, actually, not 4 miles away from where I live. And from the day before, there was all these, like, on my phone, I get all these notifications, like, you know, it was a flood warning, flood watch, tornado warning, tornado watch, blah, blah, blah. Dogs are wrestling. Please ignore them, Southland.
Hey!
See? And then all of a sudden, at like, I don't know, 4:30 or 5, I see a notification on my phone saying a tornado has touched down in Broken Arrow. And I was like, what?
Hey!
There we go. See, just takes once. And so Carrie and I were watching it, and there was some other people from our church that live closer to the tornado, and we were all trying to get a hold of them. And I got Carrie's folks, actually. Either this and the dogs are under the desk, so if it looks like there's an earthquake here, it's because they're clumsy. This tornado, man, it was heading straight for Carrie's folks' house. And I don't know if it went like through their neighborhood or across the street, but they weren't answering their phone. Carrie was starting to get pretty frustrated, stressed, anxious, whatever. And then, so finally they pick up their phone. They're like, oh, hey, what's going on? It's a little windy here. But having one that close to home really helped me evaluate where my priorities were. But honestly, I didn't really feel scared. You know, I mean, to be honest, I was a little surprised that one touched down so close to home here, because that Moore tornado, that big storm system, that was heading towards Tulsa. And Carrie and I were watching that on the news, just keeping up to date with it. Okay. And then it got maybe half hour from Tulsa, and it just started dispersing. It just almost completely broke up. Where Carrie and I were out, we didn't even get any rain. And then we were listening to this weatherman. And he was like, man, Tulsa really lucked out on that. It's like, what? Did we? Well, we'd be all right with losing. And that's what I've been asking myself, especially having you put in such a powerful perspective. And where's our focus, man? What are we investing in? What are we investing our lives in? Yeah, we got to have jobs. We got to have money to function in this world. But it's still just stuff. Jesus said there was going to be worse and worse and worse things as the time draws nigh. So, like I said, I never understood why church is, well, why people don't equip themselves for it. Because, say a tornado tore through the church I go to, God forbid, I don't know how that would happen with the pastor we got. But, say that happened, man. I mean, is his relationship with God impacted? Is mine? What really matters besides people? You go ask any one of those people that lost everything in the tornado, all they want is those keepsakes, those tangible memories, things that have encouraged them, opened up their heart. When you see your house in a bunch of pieces of 2x4 strewn out over a square mile, and you got no roof to go under, how much does it matter if you got the people you love around you? That's what matters, man. God is still with us. God has no problem give me another house if this one goes up. Yeah. So, food for thought, I guess. I think I'm about out of things to say, which is a little long-winded of me. Lasted a little while. But man, I do plan on going back to those places. And so, tornado season's winding down. Hurricane season's winding up. Maybe I'll get to tour the country a little bit. But I do appreciate the prayers, man. And everything. That things are stepping up. So it's a good time to start re-emphasizing our focus on God. So, thanks again for everything. Love you guys, and hope to hear from you soon.